Good morning. Let's try it again. Good morning.
Good morning.
It's 9 o'clock. Time to get started. Glad you guys are here today. Let's start out with Psalm 28, verse 7. It says, "The Lord is my strength and my impenetrable shield. My heart trusts with unwavering confidence in him, and I am helped. Therefore, my heart greatly rejoices, and with my song I shall thank him and praise him." So this morning we are going to thank and praise him with our song. So as everybody kind of gathers in and makes their way in with their treats and drinks, we're going to sing a song, and we hope that you guys can jump in and worship with us. This is House of the Lord. Song says in there, "Our God is surely in this place. He promised us that where two or more are gathered in his name, he's there." So by my count, there is more than two. So he's here. Amen?
Amen.
Does that make anybody excited?
Yes.
I think that's pretty cool. The same God that created the universe is paying attention to what we're doing. A little bit humbling, but exciting too. So let's join together again, and let's worship.
Oh,
that should be our heart's cry, right? That he is magnified in our life. So now's that time where we get to give back to God and thank him for what he's given us. So I want to give you a moment as we play and get started singing this song where you can just come forward and bring your offerings there and lay them at his feet. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for each one of these who have come today to worship you, Father, to thank you, to show our gratitude for the fact that you're interested in us, Father. That not only are you interested, but you love us, Father. That you care deeply for us and for what happens to us and what happens in our lives, Father. So we just pray that you give us the grace to recognize that. Give us the wisdom to believe it. Father, I pray that you take these gifts that we give back to you today, Father, and you multiply them. Good measure pressed down, shaken together, running over in the life of the giver, but also in the life of our church, Father. Father, we love you. We praise you today. We worship you today with our voice and our songs. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
to do this, to experience this presence. So, Father, I just pray that you will open our hearts and our minds this morning to hear what our pastor has to say today. Thank you again for this opportunity. Just bless the words that he brings, Father, that we will hear exactly what you have to say to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, good morning to you.
Good morning.
We're glad you're here today. This is the day the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let me tell you, we've got some famous people here. We had the Teacher of the Year on our stage. Isn't that something? We had Papa Smurf on the drums. And we had the CMA Vocalist of the Year at the microphone. You never heard of CMA? Center Music Association. Something I just started. We had a meeting at the table by myself. So, I mean, I think you are. Don't y'all?
Yeah.
I think old boy's pretty good. Mark chapter 8. Hey, I think all of you. How many of you came out and ate with us last week? Raise your hand. See, there's a bunch of you didn't. You missed the good. We had a good meal. I tell you what. If we had had a crowd, I don't know what we'd have had. Because the food was, it was delicious. There wasn't, honestly. I'm not belittling Kentucky Fried Chicken, Lowe's Chicken, or food, whatever you want to bring in. We didn't have any of that. Every bit of food we had was homemade food last week. I'll tell you what, it settled this old man's stomach. Hey, I got something more. You find Mark chapter 8, verse 34 right quick. While you're doing that, I'm going to read you this thank you note. From Craig, Elizabeth, Brianna, and Danielle Schillenlaw. Dear church family, the Schillenlaw family would like to thank you, our church family, for all the support during Craig's cancer diagnosis, treatment, surgery complication, and recovery. As many of you know, there were a lot of ups and downs during his long journey. God definitely was present and carried him through and continues to provide him with strength and encouragement during his recovery. There are no words that can express gratitude for all the prayers, continued prayers during recovery, calls, texts, home, hospital visits, and the generous love offering that we received. The love offering has made a huge impact on our family and shows the selfless and kindness of others. We will forever hold you near and dear in our hearts. God bless you. Thank the Lord for that. With that being said, Craig has another procedure this week, and it's not that big a deal for me because it's not me. But if it's him, it's pretty big. It's stretching the esophagus, and apparently it's not that big a deal. But the process to get that for him, they have a time getting his IVs to work now. And so that is huge for him. That's the big thing he's dreading. Would you pray that might go well for him? That's big. That's Wednesday for him. So also understand that, let's see. Let me get it straight before we go on. Lee Sadler, across the street's grandmother, is in hospice care. His grandmother, Mabel, she's in Florida somewhere. So let's pray for them. So. Well, Father, thank you for the opportunity to come to your place and to worship. Great are you, Lord. We just stop and thank you. Oh, Father, we pray for these needs that we lifted here. We ask you to help for them. We pray for the anointing in this place. I pray that you'd help me as I preach and open our minds and hearts to your word that we're about to read. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name. Mark chapter 8, beginning with verse 34. And would you stand in reverence for the reading of God's word? Then he called the crowd to him, along with his disciples, and said, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny himself, take up the cross, and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world and forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels." And then he said to them, "Truly I tell you, some are standing here who will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God has come with power." This is the word of God we have given. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. The call of salvation is given to all people. God doesn't ignore. God loves all people. Doesn't matter what your economic stature is. It doesn't matter where your family lives or the color of your skin, your nationality. None of those things matter, whether you're a man or a woman, or if you're confused, you know. It makes no difference. God loves the world. Jesus issues that call that day. He said he called not only his disciples, but the crowd to him. That's the way he's always doing, calling the crowd to him, calling the people to him. And as always, some respond, some don't. And then he said, though, a sobering word. He said, if you're going to come and follow me, and that word follow, by the way, means as you continue to follow. It doesn't mean it's a one-time step, but it means as you continue following me, you must deny yourself, take up the cross, and follow me. A denial of self, and that is so different than the way the world's living today, isn't it? The way that everything is going is so selfish and self-centered. Would we agree with that? I would say to you that it's been that way for a long time. Started way back in the garden, and things haven't changed. What's changed for us is now we see it immediately. We can see it on the news. We can see it in what used to be the newspaper. We can see it among ourselves. We see it when we look in the mirror, right? That so often we don't deny ourselves, and we're far from following the Lord. We follow our selfish ambitions, our selfish gains. He said, we're not to follow our selfish interests, our earthly securities. It's not the denial of our personality that I'm talking about, because God has made all of us unique. It's not even to die as a martyr. It's not even to deny things. It's the denial of self. That very part of our inmost being that pulls us. You realize today that in our age, we have so many choices, more so than other folks have ever had. And we have so much that pulls us, that feeds our flesh, our earthly ambitions, our earthly desires, the very crass nature of our character, if you will. Jesus said, if you're going to follow after him, you have to deny yourself. You don't partake of all of that that's on the platter of this thing called life. He talks about this denial of self. It's the reorienting of one's life. It's taking the map. And if you were looking at it with a compass, you take the compass and you turn the map toward the north. You don't try to turn the compass to make it north. The compass is always going to point north. You orient the map, then you begin to work off the map. It tells you what the direction is. The Holy Spirit tells us what direction we need to walk in and whose will we need to walk in. And it's not our will, it's God's will. Deny yourself, and then he says this, it's kind of a weird statement, take up your cross and follow me. Keep on following, carrying that cross. In the world that Jesus lived, it wasn't uncommon that someone had been guilty of a particular crime that the Roman authorities ruled as capital punishment, and oftentimes you'd have to carry that cross publicly in front of everybody so that all of society saw that what you've done was so grievous that in a few short minutes you're going to be hanging on that cross. See, they didn't have the benefit of Fox News, CNN, ABC, and all these other channels telling it. They didn't have the benefit of something that ran across the TV screen. Sometimes when I'm watching the news, I declare I'm watching something, then they've got two or three layers of stuff going underneath it, trying me to figure all this news out, you know. They didn't have that. All they had was the word of mouth for the most part. And let me tell you, when they saw you going through the community with that cross on your back, people begin to talk. What did he do? What did he do? Oh, well, don't you know he was talking against the government? Don't you know? He said something about the election was fraudulent. Oh, my goodness. You start talking about that. And they knew that before long, you better not talk like that. You better watch yourself. Oh, he was trying to do this, or he was guilty, he didn't pay his taxes, or he killed somebody. You remember Fred down the street? Yeah, I remember Fred. He killed him. Oh, no. Yeah. He did that last week. They're going to kill him. There was no long lines of going through judges and going through different courts, by the way, appealing. You just didn't do that in the Roman world. It was short, sweet. Everybody remembered what you'd done. Jesus says, deny self, take up the cross, and follow him. That you and I literally take on the cross of Christ, that he crucified our sins upon the cross with. We take that cross ourselves. And publicly, we carry that before the world. Not that we put a wooden cross on our back, but by the standards that you and I live, the way we talk, the way we present ourselves, we represent Jesus Christ. And as we do that, we're not denying who he is. We're lifting up who this Jesus is. And that we do live differently than the world. Because we're the people of faith. We're the people of faith. And we live differently. Aaron tickled me. He said that he had a fellow one time, and some of you might remember when he had him come, but he was a Chinese, and he was, he came to this country and stayed with Aaron for a while, and he kept calling Aaron fat. Well, this man was a Buddhist, and he kept doing it. Finally, Aaron said, I don't throw off on your Buddhist. I notice, I'm trying to remember how Aaron said, I noticed that Buddha's fat. And he looked at him and said, you don't say he needs to lose weight. And the fellow just looked at him and said, so don't you say that about me anymore. And the man did. See, he was identifying as a Buddhist. Aaron's identifying as a Christian. How we live makes a difference. We bear the cross of Christ, and we bear it publicly before the world that they know who we are. Do you remember Jesus when he was being brought before the Roman authorities? And you remember Peter followed him into the courtyard, and three times he denied knowing who this Jesus. He denied Jesus. By the way, he conversed, the way he was carrying himself before the other people. One young girl even said in the crowd, oh, this is one of those men that follows Jesus. And he said, oh, I don't know this man. He started cussing and all kinds of things. So he didn't identify himself as a Christ follower. you a Christ follower? Because people identify you as a Christ follower. Are you not denying yourself to the point that other people don't see any difference in you? I would say to you that while we're not more effective in the world today in our witness, is because our witness isn't much different than the world. We look just like the world, not the distinctive people who are Christ followers. And that's sad. Jesus specifically says, if you're going to follow me, deny yourself, take up a cross, and follow me. Look at some passages. Romans 13:14 says, rather clothe yourselves with the Lord and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the flesh. Philippians 3, 7 through 8. What it says. Philippians 3, 7 through 11. But whatever were gains to me, Paul saying this, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from the God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of the resurrection and participate in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection of the dead. Have you thought for that which I appreciate about each and every single one of you is who you are. It's not your body that I appreciate. It's you. It's what's housed in that body. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? It's your personality. That's what you and I appreciate and love about one another. Is that not right? This is just what's carrying us. This is the space suit that's carrying us through this place called Earth, planet Earth. God put this thing on us. And for some of us, it's a nice suit. For others, it's not so attractive. But it's funny how even though the most unattractive people, when you get to know them, can be beautiful, right? Because of what's here. I've seen some beautiful people that was some... I didn't want to be around them. Amen? All right. So, some of us, our space suits don't look as good. But it's our soul, our personality, that we identify and we love. That's who we are. And you know that part is what's going to live for absolutely forever. Isn't that amazing? That's going to live forever. The Bible says one day, though, that we'll get joined back together with this space suit in this spiritual form. Now, I don't understand that. It's apparently the same kind of form because it says, as you were known here, you'll be known there, right? That's what it says. So that means Mike Craven, I'm going to know that rascal whenever I get to heaven, right? Because I know him like he is now. That's how I know him. I think his body will be a more complete body. It's not going to be, I'm not putting you down. Well, we'll pick on somebody else. Josh, dilapidated, that kind of body. It'll be whole and complete, right? Because we're in a state of decay. Let's just be honest. We are. Quit laughing, Heather. You're in a state of decay, sister. But God is going to give us a new body one day. But I do think we'll recognize it. Well, just think, that soul lives forever. That soul lives forever. And yet we act more concerned about the suit. Now, we've got to be concerned about the suit, I understand. Because you can shorten your days here on this planet Earth if you don't take care of the suit. I know that. But you know what really matters is that soul. That's what really matters. And we want that soul to impact as many people as we possibly can. So for that to happen, we have to take care of the space suit. But guess what? We feed the things that we think is satisfying the soul. Those selfish ambitions, the things of the flesh that gives us that first joy, that gives us that little bit of joy, right? Gives us that joy. The lust of the flesh, the addictions, you name it. Those things we migrate toward because Satan knows how to speak to our hearts. There's joy in sin for a season, Scripture says. That's a fact. That's a fact. And so those things we migrate toward. Jesus goes on in the same passage after he says, deny yourself, take up the cross and follow me. Look what else he says. Verse 35, for whosoever wants to save their life will lose it. In trying to save your life, you lose it. Trying to, those earthly affections. But whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. It's in surrendering and dying to self that we find resurrection. That's completely different and flopsided from the way the world sees it. It's about gratifying yourself. And he says, no. It's whoever loses his life for me will save it. That's where you find what life is in giving to other people, doing for other people, abandoning yourself, taking the time to be a blessing to somebody else. We talked about that last week. Isn't that where we really find the reward? Isn't that where we really find the satisfaction? I mean, gosh, you can go, you name the trip that you can go on, name the greatest trip you could take. Money is no object, and you and your family take that trip. But what really makes the greatest blessings of our life is not those things. It's in when we give ourselves to other people. It was amazing the other week, so many people were so hyper about our back-to-school gig we did. I mean, it was a lot of fun, wasn't it? And people just, oh, they're just so hyped up. And I like it. I'm not putting a damper on this thing, but I'm thinking, some of y'all have been around all the times we do the trunk-or-treat and stuff we do. It's the same thing. It's just a different season. And we have a ball just loving on community. And it was like some folk just discovered. And that's good. That's good. That's good because we're all in a different place. Are you losing your life for Jesus? Are you losing your life for Jesus? Or are you just satisfying the selfish ambitions of your heart? What is it? What good is it? For someone to gain the whole world, and forfeit their soul. A buddy of mine, he worked for a bank or a lending company, and he would go into your homes and he would finish the paperwork up with you in your own home. This was like 10, 15 years ago before the last housing crisis we had, you know. And he would go into all these homes and he would in Cabarrus County, and he talked about how beautiful those homes were. And the immaculate driveways and the immaculate yards, and you go in, and the people dressed so fine, welcoming in. And he said, you go in, and sometimes there wasn't hardly, the couch was ragged, or they didn't have chairs and stuff. He said, it was amazing. You had this fancy house, but they didn't have anything to sit on hardly inside the house. He said what he was discovering was they didn't have the money. They were pumping all their money into that facade. Kind of like going to these Hollywood sets. If you've ever seen, like Disney has, you can go to MGM or whatever they call it now, and you go to the back stage tour, whatever they call that thing, and you have these neighborhoods you drive through. You remember that? Anybody that's been there? You've got these nice houses, but they take you around, and there's nothing on the other side. It's just the front or sides, kind of like those Hollywood sets for the old westerns and stuff like that. There wasn't nothing there. And he said it was the same way with those houses. There just wasn't nothing in them. There wasn't nothing there. And he said he would tell the people, he'd say, he said he had more than one. Say, now, do you think we're going to get the loan? He'd say, okay, you got the loan. You're going to get the loan. But he'd say, you don't need to be talking to me. You need a bankruptcy loan. You are broke. You're not going to be able to continue this. And what most of them would do is, about all of them, would nod and hold her head down, and they got the loan. Well, you know what happened? Shortly then, they lost everything they had, right? They couldn't keep that appearance up. Jesus says, what's it like for you to gain the whole world, to gain everything the world can give you? I'm going to translate that down a little bit baser for you. What is it to have everything that Satan would provide you with? Everything Satan could possibly provide you with. To gain it and lose your soul. Remember what I said a minute ago? We're going to live forever. We're going to live forever, folks. With the Lord or without the Lord. In heaven or hell, we are going to be present from the Lord or absent from the Lord. So what good is it for us to gain all this now and to go with our eternity apart from God? That is a long trip. That is a long trip. And that's a trip that you're not going to come back on, right? I mean, that's just forever. That's not saying, wow, we got a bad motel room. Went to Gettysburg the other day, and I'm thinking I'm going to do the family right because I'm known for getting sorry motel rooms. Now, that's me. That's just what I do. I don't do it for a living, but that seems like what I do for the family. I spent money to get a nice motel room. It wasn't a nice motel room. It was awful. It was awful. It looked good on the outside till we got in there. Folks, it can look good in this life. I was able to get my stuff at about 11:30 at night, check out of that motel. This thing called life, you can't check out of it. It really does go forever. You know, sometimes you're tired. I've heard people say, I just want to die. Well, that's all right, well and good to die, but if you ain't going to heaven, you ain't got nothing to die for. Right? Forget the flames. Forget all that other stuff. You're going where God's not at. Can you imagine a world like that? Wow. Kind of sounds like Winston-Salem. I mean, it's a place I don't want to be at. Right? I don't want to be there. Because it's alienation from God. And it is a place of burning forever. You can't turn around. What does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? What about you, child of God, today? Do you know this Jesus? And if you do, are you operating with what Bonhoeffer called cheap grace? There is a price to walk with Jesus. Salvation is free, but the walk is tough. Real tough at times. Are you walking with him? Are you denying self and taking up the cross and following him? Think about that. Because there's one thing about it, no matter how far you go on the journey, no matter how tired you get, he's there with you to pick you up, to sit down with you along the way. You're not alone, and he really does want to help you. If you'll allow him to. And yes, he understands when we stumble and fall. He knows all about it. Because the cross can get heavy and the roads have potholes. He's with you. He loves you so much. Don't forget that. But think about what I said today. Let's pray together. Pardon me. Father, thank you for your word, be it the sobering message that you gave us. Lord, I pray that you'd speak to us and help us in our journey to give us boldness to abandon this old self to serve you. Lord, help us.
Let's stand together. Whispered something in my ear. I'm not sure what he said, but it was something about having someone come forward to bless something. Does anybody know what that is? That's it. Can we do that? You guys want to sing the last verse and then do that? Let's do that so we give them time to get that together. And let's sing another verse here. I know everybody knows this song. I know sometimes it's thought of as an Easter song, but man, this is pretty much why we're here, right? This pretty much sums up the whole life that we're seeking to live, right? It's all because he lives. If Jesus didn't raise from the dead, we wouldn't be doing this. So let's really focus in on why we're here and what this song means. And then one day. these folks to come forward. As they come, I want to read Psalm 121 for you guys. It says, I will lift up my eyes to the hills. From where shall my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to slip. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. The sun will not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will protect you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will guard your going out and your coming in and everything that you do from this time forth and forever. So I want to speak that over these guys right there.
Okay, is this on? Okay. So if everybody will just bow your heads and we'll pray and bless over these backpacks. Dear Heavenly Father, just we lift these backpacks up to you and we lift the children who will receive each and every one of these, Lord, because we know that you know all the stories, Lord, and we pray that you lay your hands on each and every one of them and you give them the blessings that we know you're going to give, Lord, and just be with them, protect them, and guide them and help them to make the choices that follow in your will, Lord, and just continue to help them to get through this year and to bless the homes for each and every one of them as well. And at this time, we lift these backpacks up to you, Lord, and in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. So just a quick reminder, there is a golf tournament on September the 10th. That is the Faith Seekers annual golf tournament. Please support your church. Get a team together, find somebody to play with. It's not necessarily about winning, it's just about getting together and fellowshipping and supporting the church. Thank you for that prayer over the kids. I hope that you guys have a good week, and we'll see you next week. Make sure and remember these teachers and kids that are going back to school. It's tough. Tough time for the kids, tough time for the teachers. Everybody's got to adjust. So remember them in your prayers this week. Have a good week.